You don't look so good.
I don't feel too good, neither. Freezing.
Don't die just yet, cowboy.
Here's a hot take that should really be considered lukewarm at best. Rockstar doesn't want to make anything but the world's most expensive visual novels, but the industry won't let them. And that's kind of sad. There are two main reasons I came to this conclusion. One, the storytelling in their games tends to be where all the effort goes. And two, not only is the moment-to-moment gameplay not very good in their games, it genuinely seems like the team has zero interest in improving any of those areas. This might sound like a brutal criticism, but it's really not. It's not ideal, and it's certainly enough of a problem to lock most of their work out of that coveted 10 out of 10 status, according to this random fat guy online, at least. But sometimes a flawed game with some of the highest highs in the medium is actually kind of better than a nearly perfect game, or at the very least, more personally impactful and memorable. Back in my mid-20s, I played GTA V for the first time. It was actually my first extensive experience with any game Rockstar produced. It was a revelatory experience at that. Not only did I liked it in a way that few critics discussed for more than 50 seconds of a 20-minute review. I liked the writing, the characters, and the plot. None of these things were necessarily mind-blowing, even by the somewhat low standard of AAA video game writing outside of RPGs. I thought it was pretty funny, the dialogue and characters felt natural and humanized, and the voice acting was top tier. More than that, what really stood out to me was the gameplay. Namely, the fact that it kinda sucked. The controls felt clunky and unintuitive. Controlling cars eventually felt better than it initially felt, but it never actually felt good. The core gameplay revolves around shooting that's so middle of the road, I feel like there isn't a single person on the dev team who even particularly likes shooting games. Rockstar cares about two things: a world that feels real, and a story that's at least somewhat entertaining. And I don't get the impression they give the tiniest shred of a rat's ass about basically anything else. The real question is, again, is that even a problem? I'm definitely not the first or even third person to bring up these shortcomings, and yet Rockstar is one of the most consistent money-making machines in the industry. Is it just because of their ridiculously detailed worlds and the fact that crashing cars is fun? Yes. But what if Rockstar made a game that was actually good? Enter Red Dead Redemption 2. Despite the title, it's actually the prequel to the first Redemption game. It focuses on Arthur Morgan, the right-hand man of Dutch Vanderlinde. Dutch leads a small, tight-knit, and very talented group of bandits that have wreaked havoc across 19th century America. A job gone terribly wrong in Blackwater has left the entire gang wanted dead or alive in a large portion of the country. And the story opens with the group fleeing into the northern mountains during a deadly snowstorm. This first chapter doesn't last long before the group moves south to set up shop near a small town in the fictional state of New Hanover. The whole setup does a lot to establish three key things. One, the group greatly cares for each other. Two, Arthur is someone everyone relies on despite what his humility would suggest. And three, Dutch and Micah really, really fucked up in Blackwater. Right off the bat, I love the gradual, slow-burn approach to the storytelling. We never get one big breakdown of everything that happened in Blackwater. We just slowly piece together bits of information over time, and slowly start to understand just how messed up what they did was. My first impression of Dutch was that of a well-meaning leader thrown into a difficult situation. But as I learned more and more about what happened that night, I couldn't help but question his character. Also, the guy hasn't kicked out Micah yet, and Micah is basically the all-encompassing embodiment of negative human traits, especially of the time, so that's not really helping Dutch's case. Aside from Micah, the entire crew feels genuinely complex, empathetic, and humanized. This is one of the more nuanced stories I've seen in a mainstream game, and the cast of characters is a big reason why. In other Rockstar projects, there's so much winking and artifice that it's hard to take the story seriously. Like, it's all just shallow, surface-level satire of various issues with American society. Red Dead 2 feels like it actually has something meaningful to say, and for the most part, it says it well. I think a good example is Reverend Swanson. He's a deeply conflicted man of God who is heavily addicted to drugs and alcohol. The first mission that heavily features him consists mostly of Arthur trying to prevent the man from getting himself killed. At first, it seems like the game is going to frame this guy as a joke in a very typical Rockstar kind of way, but it never really goes there. It presents the situation as being genuinely sad. None of the other gang members mock the man, they just feel sorry for him and genuinely worry about his declining condition. Red Dead 2 does a great job of making the player fall in love with the motley crew, despite the fact that they're all definitely bad people. When Arthur and Dutch rescue a woman from another gang at the start of the game, Dutch even remarks, "We're bad men, but we're different." And that summarizes the crew pretty well. It's a much more morally complicated scenario than Grand Theft Auto, where most of the cast comes across as a caricature of some abstract American stereotype from a writer who watched 30 minutes of TMZ and assumed they understood everything about the country's history and culture. Here, everyone more or less feels like an actual human being, which dramatically affects everything from the tone to the gameplay. In GTA, going on over-the-top rampages feels cartoony, like nothing that's happening is real because NPCs just don't act like real people. In Red Dead, I was much more hesitant to endanger random working-class folk because it just didn't seem like something Arthur would actually want to do. And because of the quality of writing and how humanized the cast is, it's hard to enter that GTA headspace of everyone being a walking parody of a human being, so who cares? Throw a grenade into oncoming traffic. Every time I try to pull some shit like that in Red Dead 2, it just feels wrong. And maybe the music has a lot to do with that. And yes, I know I normally talk about music at the end, and I'll talk more about it then, but just listen to this one particular track that plays when you go on a crime spree fighting cops in a populated area. This is the Saint-Denis Wanted theme, though I definitely heard it play in other towns. It's intense, foreboding, and builds in suspense and tension more and more as it proceeds. It's an incredible track that lends a genuine darkness to any rampage that it accompanies. Now, that's not to say this isn't still a Rockstar game, or that players who indulge in the simulated chaos are totally missing the point, or whatever. It's still a game, and we can have our cake and eat it too. You can go ballistic, kill 50 cops, blow up a train, and die in a hail of bullets, and suffer the horrible consequences of losing, like, $14. or just reload your save like a normal person. But the tonal distinction is still there, and it changes the entire vibe of the storytelling. This is a world you can take seriously, even if you want to go a little crazy sometimes, because by God, this studio made some elaborate environments, and if you don't get into a shootout where you're leaping across rooftops, why are we even here? Maybe there is something that tonally gets lost in the shuffle in a game where even just the main plot, you basically have to kill enough people to populate a modern American town, but that's just a tightrope that we all agree to walk on so we can use open world games to bash our virtual action figures together until shit explodes. It's a delicate balancing act, it requires a little suspension of disbelief, but I don't think it negatively affects the story in any meaningful way. We'll get back to the story in a bit, but let's shine a light on the uglier side of the game. Its core gameplay. Red Dead Redemption 2 is an interactive story first, a life simulator second, an open-world exploration game third, a horse-riding game fourth, and a shooter pretty much dead last. That's a lot of flavors to juggle, but these mechanics are great at best and mediocre at worst. First off, why am I branding this as a life sim? Well, because all of Rockstar's games have that element to it, but it's more emphasized and deliberately paced here than ever before. The most common complaint you've probably heard about Red Dead 2 is that everything moves very slowly. No matter what you're doing, it's not gonna happen instantly. You don't collect stuff by walking over it, you look at each individual thing and interact with it one by one. Red Dead 2 is a game about the passage of time, both thematically and somewhat literally. It's all about playing a particularly eventful year of a criminal's life at the turn of a century, the end of an era. A friend of mine on Twitter said the game made absolutely no compromises on its vision, and that's pretty damn accurate. Red Dead Redemption 2 was pretty damn divisive. It's a highly rated, absurdly successful title, like everything Rockstar gets their grubby little mitts on, but a lot of people just couldn't deal with how slow everything is. An absurd proportion of my playtime consists of hauling bags to the kitchen tent, or chopping wood, or skinning animals, or picking berries, or looting a body, or opening every drawer on a cabinet and taking each item individually. You get the point. Stuff takes real time in Arthur's adventure. You very rarely do something instantly with no animation. You gotta do stuff deliberately and slowly. If Arthur was a real person, he would probably be the most talented animal skinner in the world, to a deeply concerning extent. Jesus. But by video game standards, it takes forever to obtain a single pelt, especially if we're talking a large game like Buffalo. Yeah, just keep your ear away from the backside. This is easily the most controversial part of the game, and I definitely get why. Every now and then, I do wish things could speed along a bit. I actually came to really love hunting in this game, but skinning stuff, taking the high deer horse, stowing it away, going back to the carcass, picking it up, putting that on your horse, and then riding to the trapper, butcher, or camp to turn it all in, yeah, it gets pretty tedious. I don't think it would be so bad if the dedication to realism wasn't so thorough. You can only store one large thing on the back of your horse at a time. One large animal pelt, one large carcass, or one large hog-tied person you're turning in for a bounty, or doing other things with. Arthur's a good person, guys, I promise. But yeah, you can store two small animals on either side and one large thing on the back of your horse. You can upgrade a lot of stuff throughout the game, but this carrying capacity never improves. And traveling takes some serious time as well. Even with the fastest horse in the game, every journey across state lines feels like a serious commitment. And fast travel takes a while to fully unlock, and you need to reach each town and station manually before you can fast travel to that place. Is there any upside to this approach? Honestly, yes, but I don't know if it's entirely worth it. Get ready because I'm about to blow your mind with the ancient lost art of nuanced opinions in a YouTube video. While it took me a while to get used to the drawn-out process of things, it did add a degree of noticeable realism to what you're doing. When Arthur tracks, catches, and field dresses an animal, then hauls it back to the camp cook, I really feel the weight of time we're putting into caring for our demented little family. Same thing goes for chopping wood and doing other chores. Bonding with horses happens relatively fast, but it still takes a little while. You have to pet it, feed it, brush it, let it rest, protect it from gunfire and animals, tend to its wounds, and comfort it when it gets scared, and so forth. And doing all this, I formed a real, tangible bond with my fictional horses. I got attached in a way I wouldn't if you could just instantly become soulmates with whatever nag you started riding 5 minutes ago. Oh god, I just called a horse a nag. I've been playing this game too long. I love that as Arthur gets more familiar with a horse, his praise and comforting words get more affectionate. It's an adorable detail that demonstrates the soft and somewhat dorky side of the rugged ruffian in a really endearing way.
Good girl.
Every time he called his horse a good girl, I felt the need to cuddle with the strange beast that shares my bed and eats my food. Also, Arthur is a dog person. Have I mentioned that I like this guy yet? When it takes time to do something, the act feels more significant. If you follow me on social media, or you joined EmceeProphIt's Church Hole, the best Discord community ever, then you may have noticed I've been learning how to cook lately, and it's transformed my relationship not just with food, but also with my own self-care. I cook at least 2 warm meals every day, mostly from scratch, and it's been really therapeutic. Not just because it saves money and it's healthier, but because, well, it means I'm getting in the habit of investing my time into myself and improving my life, which is actually a pretty big deal for me. It's like when you set aside your plans for the evening to comfort a friend who's dealing with something rough. Even if you're not the best at picking the exact right things to say, taking the time and making the effort conveys to that person that they matter. I realize I'm getting pretty philosophical about a video game with drawn-out animations, but it's important to at least understand what the designers were going for. This slow pace was a very deliberate decision. I don't think that decision always pays off, but it does a lot to show how slow and deliberate life was for people even just 100 years ago compared to the breakneck pace of modern life. It's a kind of thing that's genuinely hard for most people to even comprehend these days, and I do mean most people. In developed countries, at least. We're very used to convenience, and so are our parents and our kids. We're several generations removed from the manual world, and I think it is pretty interesting to design a game in a way that reminds us what human life was like not long ago in such an interactive way. But, like, it can still be boring as shit. It's something I got used to, but this is the curse of artistic ambition in video games. When you're making art, it's not always going to feel pleasant. People will cry, but it's a video game, so it should always be fun. But deliberate unpleasantness in the medium is older than even the horror genre it's often associated with. While I do understand and appreciate that, I also definitely understand why some people can't deal with this game's bullshit. It's the kind of thing that will make or break the title for you, so if you don't think you can deal with it, maybe it's not the game for you. But if you can't deal with this game's bullshit, that would be a shame, because this is probably one of my new faves. It's in my top 25 at least, and when you play as many games as I do, that's actually saying something. This mostly comes down to the writing, the way the gameplay complements that writing, and vice versa. I'll get into full-blown spoilers in the last part of this review, but for now, let's deconstruct a morality system that actually doesn't suck a bunch of dumb, stinky poopy dicks. In my professional opinion.
It's kill or be killed. And right now, plenty of folk want our kind dead. So we kill. Them of us that's too weak or too unlucky, they'll be killed. Accept it. Way of the world.
In so many games with a karma system, it tends to reduce nuanced social and moral situations into the binary of good or evil. But by virtue of the entire concept of Arthur's situation, he's always going to be shades of moral gray. There are effectively two separate morality systems in the game: honor and law. The fact that these things are connected but distinct is the main reason the system works. If every broken law, accusation, or misunderstanding pinned on Arthur decreased your honor, I'd think that was a very reductionist approach to morality, but thankfully that's not how it works. The honor Arthur has is kind of similar to the abstract concept of karma. But if you know much about the philosophy regarding the ideas of karma, not just the religious aspects, you know it's not necessarily just a metaphysical force. Rather, it's a real, extant psychological and social force. Not quite physically tangible, but real nonetheless. How we act, even privately, affects our own perception of ourselves. If we act outwardly friendly, but internally curse someone's name, that negative feeling still lingers inside us. It affects our headspace. If a person is constantly fighting themselves to do the right thing, or even just keep up a positive social appearance, their inner doubt doesn't just go away. If someone is only pretending to care, their indifference will probably eventually show. That's not to say you need to have pure thoughts to be a good person. No one has pure thoughts. But okay, I'm about to quote Skyrim in an intellectual context, so get your pitchforks out, I guess. Arngeir is the leader of the Greybeards, a spiritual group of Nords who live in isolation atop the tallest mountain in the land. They practice the voice, or Thum, an ancient art of using one's voice to alter the world around them. Arngeir serves as the leader for many reasons, but most notably, he is the only Greybeard who can speak normally without his voice harming others. On my first playthrough, I had thought this was fascinating, because at first, you might think this means Arngeir has the weaker voice among his peers. In reality, if you ever dare to attack him, you'll go up against one of the strongest human beings in the history of the franchise. And he doesn't even have weapons, armor, or traditional magic, just his voice and an iron will. Arngeir can speak without doing harm because he has so much profound control and understanding of himself and his power that he will never harm someone unless he intends to. His will is like a dam holding back an infinite ocean of power, and none of that power will slip out unless he allows it to. Although the exact nature of the voice is only alluded to, Arngeir himself sums it up pretty well. True mastery of the voice can only be achieved when your inner spirit is in harmony with your outward actions. He'll also occasionally say the mantra, sky above, voice within. What I think the man is getting at, and indeed what the themes of Skyrim are getting at, is that you only truly understand yourself and your potential when your mind and body are working together to express your will. Because no matter what, these two things will be forever connected. And when they are out of sync, we say things we don't really mean, or do things we regret. This is a really nice portrayal of a very fundamental part of human nature. Virtually all people want to be good and minimize the harm we put out into the world. But wanting to be good but doing bad doesn't change the end result. Trying to do good, even when your circumstances all but force you to do harm, well, it's not perfect, but it's a start. It's also a more interesting, relatable narrative than having a literal bandit suddenly be a goody-two-shoes. Red Dead Redemption 2 is all about the consequences of a single criminal's life and legacy. In so many stories, the main character is just a vehicle to experience a tale. But in this case, Arthur Morgan is Red Dead Redemption 2. It's all about him. I would say everything else is pretty secondary. It's about the moral struggle of a man to either do the right thing despite his circumstances, or use his circumstances as an excuse to continue doing wrong. How he expresses his will in the moments that are up to him, that are up to us, the player, and within his control, says everything about him, and also says a lot about us as players and people. As the story proceeds, Arthur starts narrating certain entries in his journal, occasionally remarking on his dreams. If you have low honor, you see a dark-furred coyote stalking prey in the night. If you have high honor, you see a buck walking through a sunlit forest. I like that you don't have these visions and narrations right from the start. It's only once the player has had enough time to start morally impacting the world that Arthur starts really reflecting on the condition of his soul. The way he slowly becomes more contemplative and even sentimental kind of foreshadows the end of his journey, but we'll get more into that later. If you've ever played Red Dead Redemption 1, you know that this situation does not end well. We'll get to that. In terms of moral action, you have all the basic stuff. If you stop to help people being mugged or being attacked by animals, you gain honor. Same thing if you capture bounties alive and turn them into the authorities. You even gain honor for turning yourself in and serving your sentence after committing a crime. You can effectively farm honor by donating money, food, and valuables to the camp, or do chores around the camp. This is a fairly slow process, and it's eventually not really available anymore, but it can debatably cheapen the complexity of the honor system. You can also farm honor by simply greeting townsfolk and being friendly, which is something you can spam while traveling around town with no downside. Because of this, no stain on your honor feels particularly lasting in any significant way. At the very least, it is easier to lose honor than to gain it, which thematically makes sense. Just go on rampages, act selfishly in choices and interactions with others, and so forth. You will absolutely lose honor just doing what Arthur does for a living, but notably, I found that you very rarely lose honor in story missions, even if you're gunning down countless people, as long as those people are cops, bounty hunters, or rival gang members. So Arthur's honor predominantly comes down to the player's actions in non-mandatory missions and open-ended gameplay, with a few choices here and there. The canon story content mainly diverges at the end of Arthur's journey. Otherwise, you're effectively along for the ride, making occasional moral choices along the way, but generally being a typical violent criminal with a soft spot for his crew. But these mostly linear missions do display a lot of the nature of our crew, especially our main character. Arthur is one of my favorite protagonists in really anything. His entire demeanor is so endearing, humble, and awkwardly adorable, despite being a genuine badass at the same time. He feels very human, both in terms of his outlook, his emotional complexity, and even his appearance. A tiny detail I love is that he has this one patch on his chin where his beard just doesn't grow properly. It took me a while to notice, but it's a nice visual reference to how this guy isn't really meant to be seen as perfect. He's still a cutie, though. I care so much about this man, and that is going to backfire on me in a catastrophic fashion. Again, we'll get to it. Arthur is depicted as the ace of the gang, the best fighter, possibly by a long shot, only really rivaled by Micah, and we're definitely better than Micah. This kind of recontextualizes Arthur's role as the typical badass wish-fulfillment protagonist. Arthur is canonically the type of outlaw that people wrote legends about. The kind of impossible sharpshooter who takes a fistful of buckshot to the gut, grits his teeth, and smokes a dozen lawmen in less than a dozen seconds. That's why there's such a robust auto-aim system and the dead-eye power that lets you slow down time to perfectly place your shots. Because Arthur is very, very good at killing people. He's also a surprisingly good leader, keeping a level head in dangerous situations and guiding his juniors with a firm but sympathetic hand. He is strategically sharp, quick-witted, and much more observant than he lets on. But most of the time, Arthur plays the fool. He stays humble, downplays his abilities, and often claims he doesn't do much thinking. But his actions speak louder than words. Arthur is a thinker, both tactically and philosophically, and in his line of work, that's a definite double-edged sword. It's kind of the worst of both worlds. He's smart enough to know that Dutch and Hosea are leading them into worse and worse situations, but he's too humble to really stand against their authority as the elder statesman of the gang. He genuinely loves and respects these people, but it turns out that being willing to follow someone through hell and back isn't always a good thing. In the real world, when people truly go to hell, it tends to be a one-way trip. There's this moment when one of the gang's debtors confronts Arthur during a collection run, and the woman asks him if he ever thinks about eternity. And while Arthur tries to hide it, he definitely hesitates for just a moment before laughing it off. Arthur is thinking about eternity, but not out of fear for his own soul, but out of genuine regret for making the world a worse place. The most brilliant aspect of Red Dead 2's storytelling is the dichotomy of freedom and conformity as American ideals. The gang members talk about it constantly. The world is changing. People have no patience for outlaws anymore. Folk have definitely decided that freedom is important, but that it has to be balanced against safety and morality. The world is marching toward a time that has no place for people like Arthur or Dutch. And I think the most heartbreaking part of it all is that Arthur is self-aware enough to acknowledge that maybe that's for the best. We'll get back to Arthur Morgan's arc in a bit, but for now, I just want to say he's easily one of my favorite game protagonists ever. He's right up there with Keim from Lost Odyssey, Lloyd from Symphonia, and the detective from Disco Elysium. That's a very eclectic collection, but yeah, he's just a very rich, heart-rending character caught in a problem that's impossible to solve. Love this man. Make more leads like this guy, game industry. Getting back to gameplay, as I said before, there's not much going on in terms of complexity. Combat is brief, simple, and feels like it's just there to lend some context and variety to what you're doing. Exploring is really fun, more on that later, but traveling and racing aren't exactly deep mechanics. Gameplay is uniformly basic, but there was one form of gameplay that genuinely had me hooked from beginning to end. Surprisingly, it's the hunting. I say surprisingly because hunting is effectively completely optional in Red Dead 2. There's one or two early missions that introduce the concept, and that's about it. Otherwise, you can complete the game while totally ignoring what might be its most fleshed-out mechanic. But doing so would be kind of tragic because in a title that simply doesn't have a lot going on in terms of its gameplay, hunting feels like the one area that had a lot of thought put into it. Out of all the ways to make money and support your gang, hunting is one of the only legal methods to do so. It's less glamorous and you're never gonna make robbery money doing it, so I can see why people tend to neglect it. Small game will get you around $2 to $3 total, large game ranges from 4 to 7. And it's not exactly an efficient way to make bank compared to, well, banks. Thankfully, there are some major incentives to doing it anyway. The most significant thing is the satchel upgrades. If you get enough animal skins of different types, Pearson can increase the carrying capacity of certain goods like food, ingredients, crafting materials, and medicine. Most of the other rewards you earn are effectively just trophies. You can get upgraded saddles for your horse by turning in certain skins to the trapper, but you can also buy similar upgrades at stables, and the difference is purely cosmetic. You can make a wide variety of clothing, a lot of which looks really cool, but again, there's no mechanical benefit to the trapper's unique outfits. I'm really selling you on this side activity, huh? I just spent 3 paragraphs describing how this stuff is almost completely pointless, but here's the crazy thing. It's fun. I know, right? like a mechanic in a Rockstar game that's actually fun in and of itself with no need for extrinsic rewards or cutscenes to be engaging? What a novel concept. Once you get invested in hunting, the overworld truly comes to life. If you ignore all the wildlife in the world, traveling can be kinda dull. But once you get invested in this stuff, you'll see the environment in a whole new light. Every now and then, I'll come across a rare animal, drop everything I'm doing, and the chase is on. The details in the environment lend an innate unpredictability to the chase if you're on horseback, bobbing and weaving through the trees and rocks to stay on your quarry's tail. And that's just one style of hunting. Generally, you have three different approaches: stealth, pursuit, and surprise. These all have their own upsides and downsides, so let's go through them all. Stealth is pretty self-explanatory and is mostly useful for tracking and killing the legendary animals, since they all but require you to stalk them on foot with no horse. I like the tension this creates because, aside from the legendaries, you need to kill animals with a single clean shot, using the proper weapon to do so depending on the species. Stealth can be reliable and precise, but it needs some careful preparation and foresight. Pursuit is my preferred way to bag medium to large game. This allows you to stay on your horse and either time a well-aimed headshot with the proper weapon, or use your lasso to catch and quickly kill the animal with a knife. Pursuing a target, keeping track of them as they dive into bushes and cut through forests, is pretty fun. And when you stumble across something rare, you really feel the pressure because it's actually very easy to lose track of the animal in certain environments. I also swear I've seen things just despawn off-screen really quickly if they get too far away, but it's obviously hard to prove that with footage. Surprise is, well, exactly what it sounds like. You encounter an animal while traveling and react quickly to take it out. Around a corner in the woods, see a target, and headshot it without skipping a beat. This gets pretty intense in situations where you encounter predators. Wolves, bears, and cougars are just rare enough that when they suddenly show up, it usually catches you off guard. Even a well-trained horse will get nervous and harder to control when one of these things rushes you, potentially resulting in your steed bucking you off if you don't react fast enough by either fleeing or fighting. Also, I don't know who at Rockstar got mauled by a mountain lion at some point, but they are legit the scariest enemies in several of their games. Ay, mierda! Being able to keep your cool and finish off a bum-rushing beast in one hit is really satisfying. Hunting does a lot to spice up travel, since you can easily come across an animal with a pelt or body part you need to get a specific thing crafted, even when you aren't actively looking for it. It adds a lot of texture to a game world that otherwise feels like a very big, very pretty, very empty field. Like I mentioned, you need to use particular weapons on certain animals to get a clean kill. Some of these matchups are a little silly in how specific they are, but at least most of them are rooted in some kind of logic. This is really easy to figure out if you've lived in the southern United States. If you find it in the dumpster every morning, it's probably a varmint and you kill it with a varmint rifle. If it tries to eat your cat or your chicken at night, that's a bastard, and you kill it with a bastard sword. Easy enough. This is why so much of my hunting footage has me on horseback. While traveling on foot, Arthur can only carry two larger weapons and two sidearms. But on horseback, you have basically as many weapons as you want at all times. Slowly learning how to hunt certain targets, what weapons were good for what regions, and getting better at the delicate timing of the hunt was a really rewarding experience. I'm not into hunting in real life, but if Rockstar made a full-blown hunter simulation in a huge open environment, I'd probably play the hell out of it. As it is, hunting is just complex enough that it merits a little strategy and preparation without being complicated or something you need to go out of your way to do. I'd highly recommend waiting until you have one of every type of weapon before really getting into it. You'll need two kinds of rifles, one high power and one varmint, one repeater, and a bow with different types of arrows to be ready for everything. Shotguns are the exception for obvious reasons. You use the other weapons if you want to collect something pretty. You use the shotgun if you want to cause a closed casket funeral. Sadly, the other side activities are really nothing to write home about. Table games like dominoes or poker are exactly what you think they are. Five Finger Filet is also kind of fun, but it's actually pretty challenging at the higher levels. The real joy of these things comes from the conversations you can have while playing, which is why the best place to play tends to be the camp. You can have all sorts of talks with your friends, often learning little details about them or Arthur that doesn't really come up anywhere else.
So I've been meaning to ask, what's that flower you keep by your bed?
Oh, there's something my ma always liked. Kind of a good luck charm, I suppose. They only grow out west, in parts of California and Oregon. I always try to grab one when I'm out that way.
That's nice.
I don't remember too much from back then. I was so young when she passed, but I remember that for some reason.
The only trade-off is the low stakes. You're either playing for nothing or next to nothing. But that's not much of an issue. You're probably not going to hit it big as a card shark, no matter what. This stuff makes for a decent diversion, but there's even less direct incentive when compared to hunting. If you want to pursue it for completionism's sake, I imagine it'll get really dull really fast. But playing a game with the locals every so often, soaking in the atmosphere and hearing local rumors, yeah, I get the appeal of that. It's not something I ever felt the need to dedicate a lot of time to, and I doubt I'd notice if it was gone, but I'm still glad it was included as an option to spice things up from time to time. Also, this game made me realize I have no idea how to actually play dominoes. Why do I keep losing? How the fuck does this work? But these are all just side activities. The main draw of the game's open world is definitely exploration. You can find some truly wild stuff out there, many of which are tied to specific side objectives, like finding rock paintings and carvings from an ancient tribe, discovering dinosaur bones, dream catchers, and weird landmarks for Arthur to sketch in his journal. One of the most intriguing things I stumbled upon was a pagan ritual of some sort, presented with no real context as to its purpose. It's just this haunting little detail out there in the woods for you to discover. I got a cool mask out of it, at least. I'm sure this is hygienic. One thing I kinda hate about most open-world games is that they all effectively have the same problems, even the good ones. Even the ones everyone insists totally change the landscape of the genre, despite doing the same exact shit everyone else does. All these games have massive open levels with tiny smatterings of meaningful, often repeated content spread across random dots of the map. Most of the core mechanics are simple, meaning that battles, traversal, and puzzle solving never gains any real depth as the story progresses. You're essentially just doing the same thing over and over again in slightly different ways. To my surprise, Red Dead Redemption 2 doesn't really do anything to break this mold. Doesn't even really try. And that's not surprising, actually. What is surprising is that I kinda like it anyway. In true Rockstar fashion, the core gameplay loop feels like a bit of an afterthought, but the characters and scenarios you come across are genuinely entertaining just from the premise and writing quality alone. If you've been in one gunfight, you've kind of been in them all in Rockstar games, but at least the storytelling is engaging. Like, it's fun to stumble upon a local gang's base of operations, which is usually completely optional. You'll learn more about that gang and their effect on the local culture and political situation. But because of the basic structure of combat and character progression, even these large-scale battles don't do anything to mix up the formula. You can approach these fights in any way you like. The geography never does anything that forces you to use a specific strategy. If you want to charge in with a shotgun, you have plenty of health and healing items to do so. If you want to pick people off with a long-scope rifle, you have plenty of sight lines and cover to take advantage of. It's a situation that gives the player freedom of their approach, which is a good thing, but it never does anything that requires a modicum of specific thought or strategy. Thankfully, the world is still rewarding to explore. While you are going to spend a ridiculous amount of time traveling sparsely populated areas, at least those areas are pretty. Like all of Rockstar's games, Red Dead 2 takes place in an approximation inspired by America, with completely fictional towns, states, and regions that just feel American. Believe it or not, there weren't long-lost states called New Hanover and Lemoyne that we all collectively forgot about. It's a nice compromise, allowing for creative freedom in terms of the exact details and layouts of environments while still commenting on cultural trends and conflicts of the time. Lemoyne is an embodiment of the American South post-Civil War, a land of countless contradictions with echoes of some of the country's worst injustices still resonating mere decades after the fact. Historical revisionism for the good old days that never existed pervade the statues, monuments, and ill-gotten generational wealth of the local privileged families. The primary rival gang of the region are a pack of young men who insist that Lemoyne is an independent state, perpetuating the war that was lost nearly 40 years prior. Playing with historical accuracy is a risky business, but I think Rockstar strikes a harmonious balance. Historical revisionism is only really a problem if you're either claiming to be totally historically accurate and then lying, or trying to downplay or reinterpret important events and injustices. And Red Dead 2 doesn't do either of those things. It definitely doesn't shy away from the uncomfortable reality of America at the turn of the century. One of the most notable examples is a side quest called The Inequities of History.
You okay?
Do I look okay?
No. You look awful.
Awful. Look at me. Useless. I wasn't born to this. I didn't deserve this. I used to be a gentleman. Jeremiah Compson. Compson's stead.
Good for you. If that's anything to boast about.
They took everything from me.
Who did?
They.
And what did they take?
My whole life. A whole way of living, a career.
I stole a lot of things, but that's quite a lot to steal.
Look at me here, living in the shit and in the mud.
I'm sorry.
This mission is very simple, but the storytelling does a lot to comment on the mentalities of the time. Arthur meets a depressed, drunken man in a small town in the south. This man goes by the name Jeremiah Compson, and he wastes no time telling you about the supposed injustice he's faced. He was once a respected professional, but all his assets, including his home, were seized by the government after he failed to pay his dues. He requests that Arthur retrieve some of his belongings from the house, and Arthur obliges, eager to help a man down on his luck. When you get to the house, you slowly rifle through the man's memories, including several notes and letters from other people in his life. Folks commending him for a job well done, thanking him for recovering their property, and congratulating him on a successful career. And then you get to the basement, see the chains on the walls, and you've probably already figured out what's going on before you've read his ledger. Compson's career no longer exists because he was a professional slave catcher. He tracked down men, women, and children alike and turned them back in to their slavers. A detail that really strikes me is how cheap the price on some of these folk were. Compson was ruining the lives of human beings for a few bucks a head, and even back then, it wasn't that much money. He had to turn in a lot of people in order to make ends meet. Presuming you've got a soul to speak of, this revelation will make your blood boil, and Arthur is disgusted that he even came close to helping a man like Compson. Arthur goes to the man's camp and confronts him with the reality of what he's done. Predictably, Compson tries to argue that it was honest work from a different time.
I was respected once. I had a profession.
You asked me to get you something.
There's no bringing back what I want. I want my job, my pride, the respect accorded to a gentleman.
What about this old crap? Huh?
My things. Don't you understand? Those bastards, they changed everything. I was a good worker. I took pride in my work. They took it away. pissed on my legacy.
Old man, some jobs ain't for saving. And some legacies?
Oh!
They are for pissing.
What are you doing? That's my history! Damn you! I still exist! Oh!
This might be an optional side mission, but it feels pretty essential to the central themes of the game. Think about the year the game is set, 1899, right before the turn of the century where both technology and civil rights would advance faster than any other period. A lot of people talk about how this story reflects the end of an era for desperados and bandits, but it's also the end of an era in many other ways. The injustice of bondage isn't something that was justified for hundreds of years and suddenly became cruel in 1865. Several generations lived and died being treated as innately less than human, like a commodity, and when they fled for a real chance at life, they were regarded as lost property. Arthur's right to piss on the man's legacy because, even if it was considered normal at the time, there's nothing normal about it. To most of my audience, I'm sure this commentary seems pretty obvious. But to this day, there are people who try to frame slavery and genocide as greatly exaggerated, claiming it wasn't that bad and that it was simply the norm of the time. So putting frequent emphasis on the reality of history and making it clear how cruel this shit was regardless of the time and context is actually making a pretty clear statement even in today's political climate. Political commentary isn't pointing at everyone and everything and mocking them all equally. Unlike GTA, Red Dead is actually willing to take something of a stance and make a statement it knows is going to piss at least some people off. I know slavery is irredeemably bad and always was shouldn't be a controversial statement, but there's a very vocal, often very influential group of people who try to play it off like it is. A lot of those people play video games, so while it's not the bravest artistic statement of our generation, I still appreciate Rockstar telling those people to fuck off. The story generally tries to touch on the uncomfortable aspects of the time pretty frequently, and to my 95% white American ass, it seems like a pretty sensitive, nuanced portrayal. They make it clear how brutal a lot of things were back then, particularly the events of the Civil War and the genocide of the indigenous people. There's one particularly haunting encounter I made with another drunk, but this was a man with a truly guilty conscience, and he deeply regretted what he was a part of.
Fitting that I'd be drinking the devil's brew. I'll be seeing him soon enough.
You're a place called Four Rigs? South of Strawberry. Kept Indians penned in there like cattle. I ain't know what's worse. Seeing the ones we killed or watching the other ones die. The slow way. Well, they pay well. Them government boys. But the money don't last long. It's what you did. Sticks around.
I don't know the feeling.
I was a young man then, but I still see them faces as clear as yesterday. I do. I might risk the last minute feeling very sleepy all of a sudden.
This guy only alludes to his actions in somewhat vague terms, making it clear he didn't want to go into the details, but he is certain that his soul is hellbound for what he participated in. What I find most memorable about this encounter is, well, that's it. I met a man, damn near drinking himself to death in a rainstorm. No matter how intoxicated he becomes, he can't erase his past. He can't change what he's done to the native peoples. He breaks down and drifts off to sleep. And then, you just sit there until you eventually decide to get up and walk away. There's nothing you can do to help him, nothing you can say to make him feel better. What's done is done. And you, this man, or Arthur, can't do a thing about it. I can't help but feel like this also ties into the inevitability of time. Just like you can't stop the march of progress and change, you also can't change what's already happened. It's grim, but for injustice on this scale, sometimes it's important to acknowledge mere words of regret don't change a damn thing about the reality of the situation. There's no bright side, no silver lining, just the cold, hard reality that the oppression and mass murder of certain groups of people is a fundamental building block of this country's history, and nothing will ever make up for that. Red Dead Redemption 2 always puts a lot of emphasis on its realism in terms of gameplay and pacing, playing up these elements as something that contributes to the immersion of the setting. But that realism also applies to the themes and storytelling. Arthur can make a difference, he can help people, he can make people's lives better, but against the forces of time and change, there's only so much he can do. When you witness the echoes of horrors, both past and present, it's those times when Arthur simply sits in cold, deafening silence, knowing that there's nothing a single person can do to change what's already happened. To expand on this topic, I'd like to draw attention to a term I often see misused and oversimplified, but it's very relevant to what we're talking about. Presentism, which Oxford defines as a noun, meaning uncritical adherence to present-day attitudes, especially the tendency to interpret past events in terms of modern values and concepts. This is basically the act of looking back at the past actions of our ancestors and judging them as foolish, ignorant, or even cruel by the standards of our current knowledge. This applies to science, strategy, engineering, philosophy, and of course, ethics. The problem-solving and morality of our ancestors looks ridiculous to us today. Thus, we often trick ourselves into thinking these actions were either extraordinarily stupid or extraordinarily evil, or both. In reality, yeah, it was deeply harmful that we thought leeches could suck diseased blood out of our bodies and cure us of any ailment. Hi, Sophie. But that was accepted medicine across North Africa, Europe, and other places for a long period of time. And yes, enslavement is something a huge portion of civilizations of every creed used, convincing themselves that by some arbitrary metric of class, race, or ethnicity, certain humans were simply lesser. But that doesn't change the harm. The harm is still real, and its echoes will resonate long after the last slave is freed. Just like people who perished in agony due to medieval medical practice don't come back to life simply because doctors later realized how medicine actually works. The thing that caused the damage has context. There's a reason it was done, but that's not the same thing as justification, and it doesn't remove the damage that has been done. Unfortunately, I often see the word presentism invoked as a blunt instrument to beat down any critical examination of the past as a way to examine moral concepts at all. Statistically, there might be someone who watched this previous section, accused me of engaging in presentism, and is now wondering if they should delete or edit their comment. The answer is yeah. Yeah, you probably should. The real issue with presentism is using it as an excuse to say, well, we're so much better than the humans of the past, so we can slow down a bit. We don't have to reflect too hard. We don't have to grow too fast. We don't have to adapt that hard. This applies again to both our practical knowledge and our moral understanding. The modern era of intense, pervasive ethical debate can be exhausting. But it's just societal growing pains, and it's a side effect of the internet doing a lot to level the information playing field. More of us can voice our experience than ever before, and more of us have more information and context than ever before. It's not like problems are just being spontaneously created, we're just more acutely aware of more issues than ever before. We, as a species, generally want to do better. We're actually very hard to satisfy in that way. Our standards of goodness and fairness generally go up over time, along with our standards of living. We are, collectively, driven to improve things. And part of that is looking backwards and seeing what we got wrong along the way. So yes, presentism, when it's used as a non-critical, smug dismissal of our ancestors as immoral or foolish just for the sake of inflating our own egos, that's pretty damn useless. But acknowledging past injustice and its ramifications on the present? That's actually useful. And acknowledging that we are likely currently doing things that future generations will regard as backwards or cruel? That might be even more useful, because it keeps us humble, and it makes us reflect on our actions. In many ways, we are collectively better off than past generations. But that doesn't mean we're enlightened, perfect beings. We're just further along the road. And presuming we don't destroy ourselves in the next 50 or so years, we're gonna be ancient history to our ancestors in the blink of an eye, either way. And personally, I do hope our descendants make us collectively seem a little foolish by comparison. Damn, that was heavy. Let's take a break to talk about something a little more fun. How about the crew? Dutch's boys, and girls, make up one of the most eclectic and lovable bands of misfits I've ever seen in any story, game or otherwise. I'll talk a bit more about John, Dutch, and Micah in their own sections because they're just human-shaped spoilers and all of them merit a lot of analysis just on their own. One of my absolute favorites, who is probably a little controversial amongst the fanbase, is Uncle. That's his name, just Uncle. He's one of the oldest members of the crew, which he loves using as an excuse for sitting in the sun all day, singing songs, drowning in whiskey, and avoiding manual labor like it's the plague. I can see him rubbing some players the wrong way, but he's undeniably the life of the party. Every time the team has a big victory, he'll be leading the chorus, telling tales, and strumming on his banjo. He rarely has anything to do with said victories, but he's the best at celebrating them. Javier is another prime example of a good guy caught in the wrong place at the wrong time, and in many ways he feels almost too good to be part of this crew. He's the most loyal member of the gang, and grew up watching older relatives be killed just for protesting landowners for better pay. He had to flee his home in Mexico when he became a wanted man, and now he lives by his own moral code. You can tell the man's been through a lot, but relaxing next to him while he plays a gentle tune on his guitar is some of the most charming content in the game for me. He's just a character with a lot of soul. Susan is effectively the team mom, and is the oldest woman in the gang. She keeps everyone in line, making sure the essential day-to-day chores and finances are handled. But she can also absolutely hold her own when she needs to, and it's implied that she was one of the best sharpshooters in her prime. And when one of her girls is kidnapped or in danger, she is not somebody you want to mess with. Lenny also stands out in a major way as someone who is way too smart to be in this kind of life. But the options for an educated black man in 1899 weren't exactly bountiful. It really messed me up when I found out he wasn't even 20 years old yet, and it was one of those revelations that informed my eventual conclusions about Dutch's true character, but I'll get into that later. Lenny is actually the first member of his entire family line to have been born outside of slavery, and he's acutely aware of how white folk tend to view him. Him and Arthur have one of the most brotherly connections, and it's genuinely adorable, but you can tell Arthur wants more for the kid than this kind of life. It's really hard to sort through all this footage and find the specific scenes I need to show all these things, but pretty much the whole crew has a few moments that make them stand out. Charles is a super reliable guy who only joined recently, but quickly became one of the MVPs. Karen is a boss-ass bitch with a drinking problem to rival Arthur himself. Pearson is the only reason anyone has anything to eat, but simultaneously isn't that good of a cook, which to me says that every other member of the crew is so bad at cooking they basically kill everyone with a single dish. So maybe they should stop bitching about Pearson's cooking? Just putting that out there. It's a beautiful gang of walking disasters, and heading back to camp to relax and chat with everyone is always a delight. I honestly had a lot of fun just doing basic tasks, greeting teammates, overhearing conversations around the campfire, planning for future missions, exchanging small talk over a cup of coffee, and absorbing the ambiance when my friends play some music. These moments really make you appreciate the time you have with the crew, which makes the eventual conclusion all the more tragic. I could go on about the gang members for days, but we'll get back to that later. For now, let's talk a bit more about time. All of Red Dead's themes revolve around the inevitability of time. This is definitely true of the first game, but it's much more pronounced here in the sequel. When Arthur and Dutch visit Saint Denis, the most modernized city in the game, they react with a visceral disgust, looking at the future of humanity.
Big cities, they're
always repellent.
Exactly.
They don't specify exactly what it is they hate about metropolitan life, but you can pick up on it over the next few missions set in and around the city. Saint Denis is one of the most well-realized environments I've ever seen in a game. There's plenty to do here, but I kinda wish there was more just so I could spend more time in this setting. The world map of GTA 5 is very impressive, but something about the smaller scale of Denis makes everything feel more detailed and intricate. The back alleys, the rooftops, the shops, the bars, and the hotel all feel so familiar to me, despite the complexity of the place. It's like a real city. Easy to get lost in at first, but eventually you know it like the back of your hand. This is simultaneously the best place to relax and soak up the atmosphere, and the best place to wreak total havoc. The level geography here makes it incredibly fun to get into shootouts and whatnot, but for the most part, there's not much of a real reason to do so. I always found it interesting that Rockstar's games are built with chaotic rampages like this in mind, but the story virtually never puts you in a situation where you actually need to do it. It's like the potential is always there, bubbling beneath the peaceful surface. 1 second you get on the wrong horse, 10 seconds later you're the worst mass murderer outside of elected office in American history. We've all been there. I absolutely adore the vaudeville-style shows you can see in the local theaters. Again, there's no reason to attend these things, but they can be genuinely entertaining and really lend a lot of immersion to the time period. In fact, going to one of these shows is a big part of one of my favorite optional missions. A bittersweet tale of another life unlived. Fatherhood and other dreams. A lot of the best character development for Arthur is technically completely optional. along with the missions where you assist Brother Dorkins and Sister Calderon, which I'll talk about later, this is one of those side quests that feels like it's mandatory to fully understand the story. During Fatherhood and Other Dreams, Arthur's old flame, Mary, contacts him for what is probably the second time in a playthrough. Mary Lytton asks for help with her bastard of a father figure who's selling off a precious heirloom to pay for his gambling, whoring, and drinking. All the usual hobbies of the time, you know. Arthur gets the brooch back, and you have the option to go on a date with Mary afterwards. If you accept, you get to go to the local vaudeville variety show. And then, after a fun-filled evening, this happens.
All right. You better take me to the trolley now, Mr. Morgan.
Of course.
Quite ridiculous, but somehow very amusing.
Sure.
My life wasn't supposed to... Oh. Is it too late for us, Arthur?
I can't lie to you. I'm a wanted man, Mary. If anyone close to me, well, they're wanted too. And I can't have you wrapped up in there. But it's coming to an end. This time it really is.
Run away with me, Arthur. Run away right now and don't look back.
I want to. More than anything, I want to. But I've got some people I need to take care of. Once they're free, then I'm free. Then I can disappear.
But Arthur...
If we're gonna run away anywhere, we'd need money. Soon, I'll have some.
I know you won't run away. But it's a pretty dream.
Very pretty. But I will, once I get some money. I had some, but then some fool got it trapped into a town that I can't go back to. That's another story.
I'll write you.
Yeah.
I think what's most painful about this situation is this wordless sense that both Mary and Arthur are fully aware being together is a distant dream. Mary's family is flawed, for sure, but she loves them. She's attached to her own world, a world of law and order with people she feels responsible for. Just like how Arthur is responsible for the people in his gang. But these two worlds are fundamentally incompatible. With the sheer scope of what Arthur has participated in, could he really live a happy, normal life with Mary? Hell, even in just this one mission, Arthur threatened to kill a young man just for annoying him a bit. How normal of a life can this guy really live after all he's done and been through? And that might not even be the most significant problem. I think one of the most tragic aspects of Arthur, and one that the character himself doesn't draw a lot of attention to, is that he actually already had a child, with a waitress named Eliza. Although Arthur had the kid out of wedlock, he was affectionate with both of them, and would often visit and stay with them for days at a time, until one day he went back to see them and found two graves in the yard. The pair were robbed and killed, for a total of about $10. Arthur makes it clear he never really got over either death, but particularly Isaac's. He simply says he was a good kid. Seeing how Arthur interacts with Jack, John, and Abigail's son, it's clear the man wants to be a father, and surprisingly, I think he would probably make a pretty good one if he could live a normal life. But he can't. And think about how the man must feel. He's a robber, a killer. He's got a code, he's got standards, but that doesn't change the fact that more or less he's in the same line of work as the people who took his previous family from him. If he took Mary to run away with the gang and live in a foreign land, would he want a child? Would they be able to give that child a good, stable life without being pursued by the law? Does Arthur even think he deserves such a peaceful, picturesque life? I don't know. But the awkward pauses and painful looks exchanged between the man and a woman he clearly loves, it's enough to make me contemplate all these things. That silent, unspoken understanding that at the end of the day, both of these people, they know they're just dreaming. But it is a nice dream, while it lasts. Once again, Arthur is powerless to change the past, and his future seems less and less hopeful by the day. Time rears its ugly head once more.
You know, I used to be a great beauty. And an even greater wit. Darling, time. What a total bastard it is, huh?
Something else I notice about the theme of time ties into the realism the game goes for, both in terms of gameplay and these very specific background details. I already talked about how the slow pace of your actions is a big part of the theme, but let's talk a bit more about the tech of the time. The first thing that strikes me is your weaponry. Namely, it's a lot more advanced than I thought weapons of the time were. But after doing some thorough research, it's pretty clear that Arthur's gear is almost completely period accurate. The exact physical appearances of the guns are a little different from their real-world equivalents, mostly to avoid copyright and other legal issues, since several of these gun companies either still exist, or at least these weapons have modern copyright holders who still own these designs. That being said, it's clear that a lot of attention was given to making them as functionally identical as possible. These are weapons of the time. And in this effort, Rockstar presented me with a pretty grim image of humanity's priorities with technology. In the 1890s, the first semi-auto and full-auto pistols were created, meaning it's actually historically accurate for Arthur to have a gun that fits in his pocket that can kill 14 people in less than 10 seconds without needing to reload. The pump-action shotgun is basically just a less efficient version of modern shotguns of similar design, able to deal lethal damage aimed at the torso from a pretty far range and strip a man's head into mincemeat at close range. Long-scope rifles aren't as powerful as their modern equivalents, but they can still kill from over a mile away with a single clean shot. Functionally, these weapons are so advanced they're kinda close to modern. This game is set in 1899. For perspective, penicillin, the first true antibiotic, was discovered about 30 years later. Non-habit-forming, over-the-counter pain meds weren't available until halfway through the next century. Electronic computers didn't exist until the 40s of the next century and were largely invented specifically to decode encrypted communications between enemy militaries. There's actually a side quest in the game where you help a scientist demonstrate his revolutionary remote control device, and the very first thing his potential investors assume is that it's being designed for military purposes. Which is kind of haunting in the modern age of long-range drones and guided missiles. And really, why wouldn't they make the assumption that it's for military purposes? The weaponry of 1899 is a lot more familiar than I was expecting, and it puts in perspective what the goals of mankind have been for the longest time. Let's get better at killing people before the other people do. That was the creed of the first city-states and the earliest cradles of civilization, and it's a creed that many nations still follow today. The violent, primal nature of people to care only about themselves and their tribe is something that repeatedly gets explored in Red Dead 2. You encounter bigoted groups like the KKK, a separatist group of Civil War holdouts, rival gangs just out for themselves, detective agencies, corrupt feds, high-profile criminal organizations. Through it all, Dutch's boys don't really feel any worse than most of them, but they also don't feel much better. You kill a lot of folk in this story, and the game is under no illusion that you're playing a hero. But what's strange is, sometimes, it feels like you are. I think one of the most interesting parts of playing Arthur is the inevitable cognitive dissonance it makes the player feel. We know Arthur is a bad man, and he constantly acknowledges and insists upon this himself. But when you're doing honorable missions, the man seems so humble, soft-spoken, lovable, and gentle. He has this very mild manner about him, and he's surprisingly sensitive or considerate to people who seem to deserve that consideration. He's a murderer, but a savior. He shakes people down one second and helps a stranger find their way home the next. He's a rat bastard who occasionally moonlights as a saint. In most contexts, this duality wouldn't merit much of an analysis. Several games let you be mini-Hitler one second and a patron saint the next, often drawing very little attention to this dynamic in any serious way. But the framing of Arthur's story as one of finding, get this, redemption, it changes the whole context. Arthur is never going to do enough good to counteract all the death and destruction he's wrought. But in trying to do some good anyway, maybe he can die with a little less weight in his heart. That's what I think is so great about this story's execution. It doesn't romanticize the situation. It doesn't act as if what Arthur's done doesn't haunt him, and it doesn't excuse his actions just because he's done some good. It presents the totality of the man, the good, the bad, and the ugly. That's why he's possibly my new favorite protagonist in all of games. He's a walking contradiction, capable of terrifying, inspiring, healing, and destructive things. In other words, he's human. Another thing I noticed is how the game world itself slowly transforms over the course of the main story. I actually thought I was kind of going crazy the first time I noticed it, but I looked it up and no, this is really happening. The world is changing that much. This is generally considered to be the most heavily detailed project Rockstar has ever worked on, and this is the quintessential example of why. Over time, I noticed new power lines, new electric lights, and similar things getting installed in the rural towns far away from the city. New buildings get constructed, and they don't just pop up out of nowhere. You see the various stages of these places being built, from a pile of wood, to the walls, the studs, and eventually a completed house. I think I've harped on enough about the passage of time for now, but I just think it's impressive how much of the game's design, presentation, writing, and environment centers this concept. It's one thing to tell us that Arthur's world is changing, but to show it unfold all around us as the background noise of our journey is some pretty brilliant world building. One of my favorite things about games as a vessel for narrative is the art of environmental storytelling. And Red Dead Redemption 2 is one of the more subtle yet effective examples of this I think I've ever seen. Now, let's talk about Dutch. This part might be controversial. I'll probably talk more about him in the conclusion, but for now, man, this fucking guy. One of the most enduring conversations about this game to this day is the morality of Dutch. This is the Skyrim Civil War of Red Dead Redemption. It's just something people are going to be debating until the end of time. At the two extremes, of course, you have Dutch did nothing wrong versus Dutch did everything wrong. But I'd say most people fall somewhere in between. Personally, the way I lean, I think no matter how much he tries to justify his actions, Dutch's actions speak for themselves. For most fans, as far as I can tell, this debate really comes down to one detail. Was Dutch always this manipulative and cruel from the start, or did he fall from grace? And I think that makes sense, because by the time the game starts, our first impression of the man is extremely mixed. We see him express genuine concern for his crew as they try to survive and recover from the botched job, but it was his actions and strategy that led to the situation in the first place. As the story progresses, Dutch becomes more and more concerned with retribution and revenge against those who harm his family or his honor.
Are you sure about this, Dutch?
Yes.
Both been through a lot recently. We hardly back on our feet yet.
And the last thing we need is to get bushwhacked by Como Driscoll. Let's go.
I know you hate him, Dutch.
He's here for us.
I doubt that.
No, you're just doubting me.
I would never doubt you, Dutch. You always said revenge is a luxury we can't afford.
This is the right call, Arthur. Take this.
There's a moment in Chapter 3 where he expresses a desire to get some vague revenge against the South by doing harm to the Braithwaites because his father died in the Civil War fighting on the northern side. The Braithwaites aren't good people or anything, they're pretty awful, but there's no direct connection between the death of Dutch's father and this one particular family. It's just not a logical motivation, and definitely not something the gang should go out of its way to pursue when they're already in such hot water. When Jack is kidnapped by the Braithwaites and passed off to another crime boss in the city, Dutch brings hell upon the Braithwaites in retaliation, and seemingly delights in dragging the matriarch down the stairs, killing all her family, and lighting the place on fire. And after getting the info they need, Dutch says to simply leave the woman to watch her life burn to the ground.
What are we doing with her?
Leave her.
I told you she was crazy.
And when you visit this area later, which is entirely optional, you find the burnt corpse of the matriarch. She was in such a state that she ran into the blazing building and burned herself to death in a grisly suicide. Again, this woman is not a good person at all, really, but it demonstrates pretty clearly that Dutch isn't above indulging in his more sadistic side. It feels badass to see the gang show up and wreck shop together like this. The soundtrack, the framing, everything about it, it's wonderful. But the way it went down just feels off. Like, you can't really enjoy the victory. I couldn't help but feel I just saw a glimpse into Dutch's true nature, and it was definitely a sign of things to come. I love all the little nuances you can uncover when it comes to this character, too. I never felt like the game was trying to spell it out for me, and I never thought the crew were uncharacteristically foolish for believing in him. The seeds of doubt are there from very early on, and the gang talks about Dutch's behavior with genuine worry when he's out of earshot. And for the folk who do maintain faith in him, it's understandable. Dutch is like family to them, a brother to the older members, and a father figure to the younger. I don't think Dutch perfectly fits into either definition, idealist in over his head, or a master manipulator who's more or less exactly aware of what he's doing to his surrogate family. I think he's somewhere in between. He just seems more complex than that. He does try to be genuine, but he meticulously rehearses and rewrites his rousing speeches to the gang, and you can find his scripts throughout camp. He treats the young men and women like sons and daughters, but openly flirts with Marybeth, who seems to be about half the man's age, while he's still romantically involved with Molly, for that matter. And it doesn't seem like it's an open relationship, considering how Molly accuses Dutch of hitting on other women. He takes in young, vulnerable people like Tilly, John, and even Arthur, gives them a place to stay, and adds them to his personal army of killers and robbers. When I found out Lenny wasn't even 20 years old yet, it made me realize how potentially insidious this situation really was. If you think Dutch is an honorable outlaw who gradually fell from grace and gave in to his vices of control, power, and vengeance, I understand where that perspective comes from. Who knows, maybe we'll find out more about the man's backstory and even play as the guy in Red Dead 3. But personally, I kinda hope not. I think Dutch's story is best left more ambiguous. It's honestly more engaging and interesting to leave it open to interpretation. In my opinion, anyway. Now for some miscellaneous stuff before I get into the last chapters of Arthur's journey. And then we'll spend a little time talking about John's stuff. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. This is all the junk I just couldn't fit anywhere else. For one thing, I don't think the prologue is that bad. I've learned over time that I have a much greater tolerance for slow openings than most people do. I also like how Twilight Princess opens. I'm okay with how Tales games tend to take a while to really get going. I think a lot of that comes down to me enjoying games for their immersive worlds and storytelling first. A calm before the storm can honestly be a really good way to establish the characters, relationships, and tone for the rest of the game. I will admit that the pacing of the first chapter is particularly slow. You never really do much of note, there's only a small amount of fighting, and you spend a very long time just slowly trudging through the snow with only a sparse smattering of dialogue to break the cold silence. I do understand what the writers were going for, though. Things are a bit grim, uncertain, and awkward for the crew right now. But since this is our first impressions of the team, we have nothing to really contrast it with. The relative quiet and despondent atmosphere makes a lot of sense. They just completely failed at a job, lost some members, and saw their leader kill a young girl when it didn't seem like he had to. They also lost a lot of money, effectively meaning that they lost a lot of their work and progress. I like slowly piecing together the reasons for the tension, but I will admit the long, silent rides through the somewhat dull, cold environments, it does get pretty old pretty fast. The intro does a decent job of swiftly introducing the tone and the game mechanics and controls in a pretty fast and fluid way, but aside from that, I definitely understand why this intro is a pet peeve for so many players. It just doesn't bug me nearly as much. Another thing I somehow forgot to mention until now is the fishing minigame. And I mean, come on, those are half the reason I play games to begin with. And this one is pretty good, if only for the relaxing atmosphere of it all. There's this gentle, lilting guitar music that usually chimes in whenever you start fishing to set the mood, and there's a few side missions where you go fishing with your pals. It's a really charming side activity, and for the most part, the minigame itself is fast-paced and doesn't waste too much time. Unless you're going for the legendary fish, of course. These bastards take a long time to reel in, which feels appropriate, but it still caught me off guard the first time. It took me 3 actual minutes to land one of these bad boys in particular. Maybe I just suck, because eventually I noticed that the legendary fish did take less time, so maybe I was still learning the ropes. But the game is relatively simple, so I think certain fish are just meant to feel like a true endurance match. If so, mission accomplished. Much like real fishing, it's all about the patience. It does a much better job of conveying the actual experience of fishing than most activities of this ilk. But like a lot of the more time-consuming stuff in the game, it's definitely not for everyone. Generally speaking, I found myself completing the vast majority of side content, and it's remarkable just how much there really is. I didn't do everything, but if achievements are to be believed, I did more than most people. I managed to collect most of the trapper's gear and hunted most of the legendary animals. The legendaries are generally a lot quicker and easier than you may think, as tracking them down really only takes like a minute or two once you're in the right area. But they do give yet another incentive to explore. Once you wander into a place with a legendary, you get a huge sketch of it with a crown above it on your map, so you can always come back later if you don't want to do it right then. On that note, I love the way the map and journal are handled, all presented with the aesthetic of a sketchbook. Arthur's a decent draftsman, and seeing his hand-drawn diagrams and doodles adds a whole new layer to the guy. It's clear the man loves nature, memorable people, and country living, whereas he's not a big fan of big cities and complex architecture. The journal is a great way to provide even more insight on one of the medium's most fleshed-out protagonists. Another small detail I'd like to point out is the newspapers you can collect. There are three publications in the game, each for various different regions. The Blackwater Ledger, the New Hanover Gazette, and the Saint-Denis Times. There might be a fourth one that I'm missing, but those are the three main ones. These papers are usually filled with a combination of miscellaneous fluff and some stories regarding Arthur and the gang's recent activities. The main thing I appreciate about them is how they offer another perspective on the crew's behavior and the consequences of their actions. It's yet another reminder that while these people are our protagonists, they're absolutely the bad guys to the average civilian in this world. Something that I found extremely fun is all the improvised optional solo heists that Arthur can uncover. There's a small selection of these throughout the various towns and cities, each attached to some kind of business, and it seems like every major settlement has at least one. First, you discover a hint of a side business at a local store. Then you poke around and figure out what's going on. Then you pull a weapon on the owner and demand that they show you what's cooking in the back. All of these scenarios enable a bit of role-playing, as you can silence the witness permanently, let them go, resort to threats of violence, and in a few instances, you actually end up rescuing captives. Sometimes you just pick a cut of a humble moonshine business. Sometimes you break up a human trafficking ring. These missions are pretty much a microcosm of Arthur's whole journey. One moment you can be a villain, and the next you're a hero. This world is absurdly detailed, and this provides yet another reward for players paying attention to the little things that stand out in each town you visit. It makes the world feel all the more alive, like there's always more going on beneath the surface of these supposedly civilized towns. I appreciate that the morality of the game is flexible enough that it allows for the player to still do some unscrupulous side activities without condemning Arthur's soul. After all, the game is bursting with opportunity to let the player steer him one way or another in regards to honor, and I love how quick and natural these moments can be. Only a few moments are treated as grandiose decisions of dramatic importance, usually at the end of the game. Usually, it's something incidental that shows the man's character. You get a bulk of the important moral choices in the game at the very last chapter, but for the most part, your honor is influenced by all the little decisions and interactions you have along the way. A few times, you get the opportunity to break up some dirty-minded peeping Toms by simply calling them out, or you can be a dirty, dirty boy yourself in those scenarios. Arthur somewhat sarcastically comments that he'll bring a horse back when he steals one to pursue someone at the beginning, but you can actually bring it back and apologize for the inconvenience to that guy. I love the little moments like that, which build up over time to reflect a believable moral arc for the guy throughout the story. Of course, it's not all quite perfect. Like most Rockstar games, the controls often feel just a little off. Like, they don't quite do what you expect them to half the time, and this is no exception. The cover system in particular is kind of a nightmare. I'm not terribly fond of most third-person cover mechanics in games as is. It always feels like I'm gluing my character to a chest-high wall. But with such large, varied environments, it's difficult to code this kind of system and make it work perfectly. I find this is particularly frustrating with natural terrain like rocks and trees that have less defined edges. Very often, the slightest tap of the control stick in the wrong direction, or simply being in the wrong place at the wrong time, will have your hero crouch run into open fire. It's pretty annoying. And then, of course, there's, you know. It's rare enough that it's mostly just funny, but your horse sure does love to trip over random askew polygons every now and then. Beyond that, the controls are fine. I learned how to work around them. They could be better, they could be more responsive, but they could certainly be worse. I'd also say the game conveys most information to new players pretty efficiently. The moment-to-moment gameplay takes a bit to get used to, since the control scheme is pretty unorthodox and there's a lot of subsystems, like most Rockstar games. I eventually got very good at controlling my horse, but it takes a while to master the complex and precise movements. This is coupled with the fact that you need to bond with your horse to really have full, precise control over it and unlock certain abilities on horseback. It feels a lot better than driving controls in GTA games, though. Just wish I didn't have to rapidly tap the A button to maintain high speed. Also, just a quick, small complaint about an aspect of the story. Like I said in a previous section, the actions of the gang mostly feel believable and at least somewhat logical given what they know. Their faith in Dutch's leadership totally makes sense in the context. But on the other hand, look, why didn't they just fucking kill Micah? Like, someone should have busted a cap in Micah's smug face before things went south a long time ago. A lot of gang members even acknowledge that. Like, Micah is not being subtle. He's not trustworthy or even vaguely predictable, and among a crew of people who at least attempt or pretend to have standards, he sticks out like a sore thumb. I get that the story is trying to convey the contentious side of blind trust and loyalty, because that blind trust lands the gang in some serious trouble down the line. But Dutch, he's the leader and he has a perfect 20 in charisma. Micah doesn't at all. Like, pretty much nobody likes him. The first time you get a good look at him, he punches another member of the gang for a mere slight.
I guess folks miss them. I fell, but when I fall, I don't want no fuss.
When you fall, there'll be a party.
A party? Probably.
Uh-huh.
That funny, huh? Sure. I don't feel like being laughed at by the likes of you two.
Stop it!
In Chapter 2, which is where the story really gets going, Micah gets caught by a random sheriff in a backwater town called Strawberry. After you break him out, Arthur wants to flee the scene immediately, but Micah insists he has unfinished business to take care of first. Long story short, you end up killing half the men in town. And we're not talking about law enforcement or soldiers, at least not exclusively. Like, just a bunch of random-ass people just trying to defend their neighborhood. You end up with a massive bounty that the player has to pay off themselves if they want to peacefully go back to that area. And more importantly, you just killed 2 dozen people for basically no reason. Why do we not just kill this man? I know I'm supposed to hate him, and to some extent, this is just the writing doing its job. He is a genuinely despicable person. But in addition to all this shit, the man is a horrible womanizer, sexist, racist, xenophobe, even by the low standards of the time period. He's condescending, hot-headed, impulsive, and sadistically cruel. If there's a bad character trait, this man has it. Everything about the guy is a liability, and he's not kept around for his charming personality, so what gives? Maybe this is a little extreme, but Micah being allowed to remain in the gang is actually treading a little dangerously close to a plot hole, in my opinion. There's an element of naivete to the cast that I can totally buy, but it doesn't really extend to Mr. Bell. No one likes him. No one really even trusts him, aside from Dutch. That's it. So why is he here? I guess the only excuse I can think of is that maybe getting rid of him seems like a slippery slope. Loyalty and safety within the gang is a very big deal for them. It's important that the family stays consistent. It's not like this detail ruins the otherwise excellent writing, but like, bro, could you really not see this coming? Micah betrays everybody, in case that wasn't obvious. Anyway, on a more positive note, an aspect I love about the writing in general is how understated it is. Very frequently, we receive major revelations about the cast presented in a fairly innocuous way. Like, it's shocking to us, but just a fact of life for the crew. The conversation where it's revealed that Arthur had a son who was murdered is just a mid-gameplay chat that takes place on horseback. Same with the reveal that Lenny is still a teenager. These are both game-changers to our perception of several characters. Respectively, the first implies that Arthur is carrying around a lot more weight than we initially thought. And the second, with Lenny's age, implies not only that Lenny is, frankly, a pretty young, impressionable person, regardless of how sharp he is, and implies that Dutch is and always has been in the habit of exploiting vulnerable young people. I mean, let's call it what it is. He's grooming vulnerable kids and teens to become a tool for him. But you only really notice that detail if you're paying attention. These revelations aren't framed as plot twists, they're just facts of life for the cast. It lends a stark, relatable, and slightly depressing realism to the situation these people are in. It's a tragedy to us, the audience, but it's just another day in the office for Dutch's boys. This blunt presentation is one of the game's biggest strengths, because it conveys just how much the crew has really been through, how much they're getting kind of jaded, and how much the intensity of their respective situations has become normal to them. It comments on the flaws of American society that led to all these people becoming desperate outcasts while humanizing the cast in a profound way, and not making excuses for their actions. It's good stuff. And with that, we've got to talk a bit more about the soundtrack. There's plenty of standout pieces. The battle music in particular is an incredible highlight. It usually captures the aesthetic of an action-packed Western movie beautifully, sounding straight out of the classic films. It all has this vintage sound, sometimes even emulating the imperfect recording quality of the time when such movies were in their heyday. A great example from a major climax of the story is the Braithwaite Manor battle theme. It has this long, almost agonizingly tense buildup as the gang walks up in a united front to the imposing fortress of the most powerful family in the state of Lemoyne. That you know of thus far, at least. This image is frequently shown in promotional art, representing the bond the gang had before things went south. And as the percussion and guitar kick in when shots start flying, you feel the hellfire this family has invoked by daring to cross Dutch's boys. It's an amazing track.
Thank you.
Another standout battle theme was the aptly named Deformed Hillbilly Fight Theme. That's actually what it's called, apparently. And appropriately, I heard it while going to town on the Murdfree Brood base of operations, a huge cave complex in the middle of the forest. I love the militaristic drum line and how the low piano tones lended a dark energy, and the horns going dun-dun does a great job of conveying the horror of the Murdfrees, one of the most brutal gangs in a game filled with brutal gangs. While I think the soundtracks for the action and combat scenes is the overall highlight, the ambient work is also perfect for setting the tone. The new Hanover theme represents what I mean pretty well. It's calm and quiet, but almost eerie, like you always know trouble is just over the horizon. A lot of the incidental exploration music has that kind of sound. These simple moments of open-world wandering can be so relaxing, you almost forget how dramatic and often tragic the story is. But the solemn tone of these tracks burrows into the back of your mind, never really letting you forget the life Arthur lives or the lives he's taken. These songs also subtly change to an even more subdued, often haunting version at night, which is always a nice touch. I'll talk about one of the more emotionally devastating vocal tracks when it comes up in the rest of my narrative analysis, which means all that's really left to talk about is the rest of the plot and the end of Arthur's story. In case it's not obvious, I'm about to spoil the bejesus out of everything I haven't already spoiled. Just letting y'all know. I'm obviously not going to summarize the entirety of this massive campaign. I think it would be fairly redundant. But I will touch on the highlights. One scene that really sticks out to me, and kind of feels like the beginning of the end, is the death of Sean.
We're stuck in the middle of some ancient feud, but instead of playing both sides, we're being used by both of them.
They were saying the Catherine Braithwaite.
Hey, hold up. This don't feel right.
Now it don't feel right? I could have told you.
At this point in the tale, it's actually been a very long time since someone in the gang died. It hasn't happened since the beginning of the game when you're fleeing a botched job in Blackwater. So, when this happens, it feels like a wake-up call, and it's a particularly rude awakening. This is what directly precedes the attack on the Braithwaite Manor. Dutch's escalation, retaliation, and pursuit of revenge represents a major step towards the storm that's been brewing since before the game even starts. The chapter is followed by the Saint-Denis chapter, in which this happens.
What is that?
It's Garrett!
What the hell have they done to me?
Look, there, the tree line.
Everybody, take cover! O'Driscoll boys are coming!
Here's a fun fact. This was the first thing I saw when I resumed my playthrough after taking a break for a couple weeks. When I saw it, I actually shouted, "Oh my God!" at my computer screen and scared the dog a bit. Mary Beth's scream is still echoing in my head days later. This is very promptly followed up by yet more heavy casualties in a following mission. Hosea and Lenny bite the dust in the same mission. And it all happens so fast that the gang doesn't really have time to process it. The thing I find most notable about these deaths is how much of a shock they are. It's at this point when things start rapidly falling apart, and the hubris of Dutch and the rest of the gang starts to really catch up with them. Then, Arthur gets the diagnosis.
What is it?
It's not good news.
I guess that.
You got tuberculosis. Really sorry for you, son. It's a hell of a thing.
What do you mean?
You're real sick. It's a progressive disease, and you'll be... Now, the best thing is rest and getting somewhere warm and dry and taking it easy. Now, is that possible?
Sure, I can just take my winters in my country club in California. No, it's not possible.
This is what does our hero in. Not a hail of gunfire, not torture, not fire, stone, or metal. Just a disease. Nature, time, and bad luck. Arthur storms through adversaries like a living embodiment of the wrath of God, but death comes all the same. I can't help but feel like TB was a conscious choice, as it's a terrible disease that is largely eradicated in America today due to modern medicine. It's actually still a really deadly disease in a lot of other places in the world due to large-scale economic injustice, but that's a rant for another day. The point is, a disease that would soon be treatable is what takes Arthur out. Having it be nature itself, rather than his life of crime that kills him, seems kind of poetic in a sad way. Time was always going to leave Arthur and criminals like him behind. The world was changing into something that didn't have a place for outlaws like this. So, it makes sense that his death isn't some romanticized victory where he goes out in a blaze of glory. He suffers and dies from a horrible illness. The only relief in his death can come from his actions in those last chaotic days on Earth.
We've all lived bad lives, Mr. Morgan. We all sin. But I know you.
You don't know me.
Forgive me, but that's the problem. You don't know you.
What do you mean?
I don't know, but whenever we happen to meet, you're always helping people and smiling.
I had a son. He passed away. I had a girl who loved me. I threw that away. My mama died when I was a kid, and my daddy, well, I watched him die, and it weren't soon enough.
My husband died a long time ago. Life is full of pain, but there is also love and beauty.
What am I gonna do now?
Be grateful that for the first time, you see your life clearly.
Sure.
Perhaps you could help somebody. Helping makes you really happy.
But I still don't believe in nothing.
Often neither do I. But then I meet someone like you, and everything makes sense.
You're too smart for me, sister. I guess I'm afraid.
Chapter 6 is the final part of Arthur's journey. In many ways, it's one of the best final acts in gaming. In some other ways, it's kind of frustrating, at least mechanically. But for the most part, it's great stuff. And this is where the game finally opens up and is genuinely different depending on Arthur's honor level and past decisions. Notably, it's impossible to tilt the gauge all the way toward high or low honor until this very chapter, where not only do your past actions start to catch up to you one way or another, but you can start influencing the state of the man's soul in his final days. One of my favorite recurring aspects of the tale is that very often when the player does something honorable as Arthur, the widow of a man he essentially killed to collect a debt from pops up. And every time she does, she looks more and more desperate, turning to sex work, which is obviously a pretty dangerous profession at the time. Her health is clearly deteriorating with each appearance, and it does a great job of twisting in the knife that just because Arthur's doing good things now, it doesn't change what's been done. In a high honor playthrough, you have the option to make things at least somewhat right with her and her son. And this is framed perfectly by the narrative. Arthur isn't seeking forgiveness because nothing he can do will undo the trauma and loss that he's caused. But he has to do something. He protects them, gives them money out of his own pocket, and tells them to pursue a better life. As the walls close in on the gang, Dutch gets sloppier and sloppier, eventually pursuing bloody revenge against all logic. He endangers himself and his crew to put people in their place, even when it's damn near suicidal to do so. Eventually, all pretense of subtlety and concern for the more vulnerable members of the crew is cast aside, and the selfishness of Dutch starts to spread throughout the gang like an infection. One character that really stands out to me and a lot of other fans in this equation is Javier. Throughout the story, he's one of the most faithful, loyal companions you have. But his behavior in the endgame makes it clear that loyalty isn't always an admirable trait. It's all about who you're loyal to. There's no honor in staying loyal to a man like Dutch, at least not Dutch during the endgame. But Javier is a man who takes his debts and faith very seriously, and it's tragic seeing him commit to such a bastard in the end. Seeing a notable amount of the gang side with Dutch is just sad. I completely understand why it happened like this, and aside from letting Micah get out of control, I don't even think the gang is being all that foolish. Dutch represents not only their family, but their future and their ability to continue living the only life that they know. He's the one with the money, even if he greedily guards its secret location. He's the one with the plan, even as his plans make things worse and worse. He's the leader, even if he's leading them straight into hell. It demonstrates that even people with as wild a life as the gang can fall into a comfortable status quo, something they don't question as things unravel around them. Members leave, Arthur kicks out Strauss, Dutch effectively abandons John while pretending otherwise, and in a climactic battle, he appears to leave Arthur behind in a life-or-death situation. Characters and players alike debate whether Dutch fell from grace or simply showed his true self, but there is no debate about what kind of man he is in that last chapter. Everyone in the story, everyone in real life, has some evil in them. But people like Micah, and in the end, Dutch, they're worse than evil. They're no good. Let's talk a bit more about the visions Arthur has in the second half of the game. I see a lot of folk characterize the animals along the lines of their common symbolism in Native North American beliefs. But even though I do agree that indigenous belief played a role here, it's not really a one-to-one comparison. Different tribes and indigenous nations hold different beliefs regarding wolves and deer, but notably, both animals are predominantly associated with positive morality and virtuous traits. So, casting a wolf as a representative of evil isn't really in line with those belief systems. Wolves are widely regarded as being very loyal, familial, empathetic, and intelligent by several indigenous communities across the continent. And observing wolves' behaviors, this makes sense. They represent the strength of the family unit due to their close ties and habit of caring for weaker members of their pack. They are powerful animals that should be given a wide berth, but they aren't portrayed as villainous in Native American stories that often. I think the most notable thing about the wolf in these visions is not the animal itself, but its circumstances. Think about it like this. A stag deer, being alone, grazing in a sunlit forest, is a natural and soothing image, as this is normal behavior for an adult male deer. They do spend time with other deer, but they spend large portions of their life alone. Arthur viewing his spirit as one that is content in moments alone represents an internal peace. This idea that he's okay with who he is. Like a buck, he's independent, but he still has bonds and will interact with his herd, his loved ones, time and time again. A lone wolf, however, is inherently living in a way that's somewhat dangerous and unnatural. It's widely estimated that less than 15% of wolves are lone wolves, because they're extremely social beings and often die a lot earlier if they live outside of a pack. Wolves are cooperative hunters and rely on their packmates to protect them. Injured wolves have a pretty good chance of surviving long enough to recover, as other members of the pack will feed and protect them while they rest. But on one's own, a wolf's life is extremely desperate and lonesome. Another aspect of Native American symbolism that is associated with the deer is the concept of sacrifice. Indigenous communities valued the deer as a food source, but respect this aspect of the animal. Thus, these creatures are often associated with sacrificing oneself so that others may flourish, which is an extremely accurate reflection of Arthur's behavior in a high honor playthrough. So it's not like the native beliefs have nothing to do with this, it absolutely does. I just find that people tend to simplify the symbolism of these two animals to deer eat plant, thus is good, wolf eat animal, thus is bad. That's not how nature works, y'all. The wolf didn't choose its digestive tract. Being on the verge of death is something that happens to Arthur no matter what you do. It's part of the core story. But his reaction is very different depending on his honor. A high honor Arthur basically knuckles down and does everything in his power to help as many people, both in and out of the gang, as possible. Even people that he doesn't necessarily like. Outside of Micah and Dutch. He pretty much hates Micah and Dutch at this point. Arthur accepts his fate and risks everything to ensure those who still have a chance at life get that chance. His main focus is, of course, on John, Abigail, and their son, Jack. Arthur wants John to effectively live the life he never had himself, and wants all the people who still have hope to get the fuck out of Dodge before Dutch gets them all killed. With high honor, Arthur realizes he doesn't have much life left, so he stops living for himself and does everything he can to live for the others. Which is a sharp contrast to the low honor route. Against all logic and sense, low honor Arthur convinces himself that he just needs to get the money for himself, escape to the West where there's better air quality, and use the cash to finance any medical expenses. He basically wants to take everything he can for himself, on the tiny, nearly non-existent chance that he could actually survive. A selfishness so vast it defies any and all logic. I gotta hand it to the writers for making both of these options feel genuinely believable for the character. I can buy Arthur going down either of these routes. I do think the canonical idea, and the more narratively satisfying idea, is that he wants to be a good man deep down. But having a conscience and listening to it are two different things. That being said, I like the high honor ending a lot more than the alternative. It feels like a truly satisfying arc where Arthur comes to genuinely understand the real, lasting harm that he's done, and realizes what really matters to him. Arthur notably doesn't really believe in reincarnation or an afterlife. To him, what matters, what he's certain of, is this life. And yet his fear remains.
I guess I'm afraid.
This, more so than any other line, embodies everything about Arthur and why he's such a celebrated protagonist in the community. The man is tough, clever, and can seemingly endure everything. But he fears not only the void, but the condition of his soul, his legacy, what he's leaving behind. He's genuinely afraid of death, but it's clear this fear largely stems from a fear that he didn't live a good life. Notably, there are two different versions of this scene, and this is the only one where Arthur admits that he's afraid. One with Reverend Swanson, and one with Sister Calderon. Furthermore, there's two versions of the scene, with the Reverend himself, one with high honor, and one with low. If you do the missions with Sister Calderon, she shows up. If you don't, you get one of the versions with the Reverend. I'm actually a little sad that you don't get any closure with the Reverend if you do the Sister Calderon quests, especially since those quests are some of the best optional content in the game. But that's really my only complaint in regards to these scenes. Otherwise, they're really great. I find it interesting that both of these conversations are with religious leaders who believe in things that Arthur himself does not. But their spiritual advice can grant him some comfort and guidance nonetheless. I know that I brand myself as a godless bisexual, which is true, but I'm more agnostic than atheist. But as an agnostic, I've had a lot of conversations that remind me of these ones. Some try to force their belief system on you, but many are like the sister and the reverend, merely offering a perspective that doesn't entirely depend on a belief in God to be thought-provoking. Seeing this kind of spiritual talk portrayed so well in a game is really refreshing, and makes these characters feel all the more real. Both the characters you can have this scene with doubt their own faith at times, and that faith is an intrinsic element of their struggle through life. As someone who did, at one time, believe in God, and someone who respects the beliefs of others, it was refreshing seeing this subject handled delicately. This kind of thing is the difference between GTA and Red Dead for me. They're both satirical, but Red Dead never forgets to portray its characters as people, and not caricatures. All three versions of this scene play out pretty differently. The Reverend notably respects Arthur regardless of his morality, but it's clear that he has a bit more respect if you show high honor. If you do have high honor, the Rev believes everything would have turned out differently if himself and the rest of the gang was more like Arthur. He says Arthur lived like a man and became a good man, and he respects that. If you're low honor, he doesn't lecture the guy, he just says Arthur lived his way and was true to himself, and acknowledges him as a warrior, one who lives and dies by the sword. I love how the voice acting portrays a much calmer, sympathetic tone from Arthur in High Honor, and a lower, more cold and gravelly voice with Low Honor. Even when he's saying the same lines, he says them very differently in the two versions of this scene. The detail in this game is truly something to behold. Either way, I still find Sister Calderon's scene to be a bit more uplifting. She acknowledges, plainly, that everyone is afraid and everyone has doubts, but helping people makes Arthur happy. So, that's what he should do, if he wants to be happy in his last days. I love Sister Calderon in this game, man. Like, she's one of the only people who truly sees Arthur for who he is and who he's trying to be. Arthur simply doesn't think of himself as good in any fundamental way, and that's obvious in his interactions with the gang. So it takes an outsider to point out all the good that he's at least trying to do. This makes an implied detail all the more obvious. Arthur simply does not consider himself to be a good person or capable of becoming good. The sister simply points out that despite that, good is what he does. Calderon is probably the biggest example of how important the optional content of this game really is, and I could spend hours just talking about all those little side missions that reinforce these main themes. This approach certainly has some risk, since not every player is going to have the same full experience of the story. Despite me being extremely thorough, there were a few missions that I missed and had to look up online. But I think the fact that you need to go out of your way to find redemption is, you know, the whole point of the story. Redemption isn't easy, so overall I think it works. Also, again, you can just go to town and spam greeting and be nice to everybody to just redeem your soul in the span of like 10 minutes. It's a good design compromise for people who want to redeem themselves at the last second, I guess. Feels like it kind of cheapens the themes a bit, though. And riding to the last mission where you confront the gang and help John escape to his new life is one of the only segments in gaming that ever actually made me cry. May the cards lay out astray. All from your command. That's the way. That's the way it is. You saved my life. You're a good man. Thank you, Bella. You know, there ain't enough kindness in this world, that's for sure. Hearing the memories of all the people Arthur has helped thank him makes it evident that while his conscience isn't exactly clear, he knows he tried. He tried to do good. He took responsibility for what he did and did everything he could to make things right. Even though a lot of stuff doesn't go well for John and the others later on, nothing will ever change the fact that he bought them time. Time for some joy, some peace, some life. And for Arthur, maybe that's enough. The lyrics of the song, "That's the Way It is perfect for this story. Particularly the last lines, "Shine light into darkness." It's overall a very grim song, but the fact that it ends with that hopeful, bittersweet line embodies everything about this guy's life. Because ultimately, that's all Arthur could really do. He lived in a wretched, desperate world, a particularly wretched and desperate niche of that world. His soul was never going to be clean, but even in that darkness he brought light into the lives of people around him, which to me is more impressive than living an idyllic life of unambiguous good and easy choices. One of the most impactful moments is when Arthur tells John to move on without him and let him be the distraction he needs so John can go try to have a life with his family. It's a powerful moment between two characters who, due to their fairly traumatic past, have a lot of difficulty expressing themselves, but in this moment they make their familial love for each other very clear. John has a lot of respect for Arthur in this moment, and Arthur truly fulfills the role of being a big brother. He has to take care of his family. John is his family, and protecting him allows Arthur to feel like maybe everything he's done isn't all bad. The final confrontation with Micah goes very differently depending on your honor. There's something truly beautiful about how confidently Arthur shrugs off Micah's bitter denial of reality, even as he painfully dies and succumbs to his coughing.
Oh, Black Lung! You ain't gonna reach that gun! You ain't! You lost, my sick friend. You lost.
In the end, Marcus, despite my best efforts to the contrary, it turns out I've won.
He claims Arthur lost, but he knows he already won. In the good ending, Arthur fades into rest, seeing one last vision of the proud buck wandering a glowing forest, heading into the sun. He dies, but in that moment, he's at peace, and he stands unshaken. And then there's the epilogue. Because, you know, this game wasn't long enough already. I have less to say about the epilogue overall. Not because it wasn't interesting, but it just feels like there's less to analyze. And that feels intentional. During this segment, you play as John Marston, Arthur's honorary little brother. And at first, I didn't think this segment was overly necessary, but after a few hours, I found it to be a nice addition. And yes, I said a few hours. It'll take you around 6 to 8 hours to beat the epilogue, meaning it actually represents about a fourth of the main story. I cruised through it because I already finished off most of the optional content by the time I got this far. This part of the tale is a little controversial, partially because a lot of people find that its length and tone breaks the momentum and messaging of the main plot. But I think that that's missing the point. Red Dead 2 changes the context of Red Dead 1 in a major way, and I think that that could only be truly properly conveyed by showing John's family having at least a few good years of life. So, we get to see that Arthur's sacrifice wasn't in vain, even if players of the first installment know that, again, things don't end particularly well for John in the future. Again, he's got a few years at least. This is honestly a very dark game that could use the levity, particularly since the last two chapters are pretty relentlessly serious. That being said, yeah, this segment does drag its feet a bit. At the time, there were definitely moments where I felt like I was just going through the motions, particularly during combat. The fights never change in this game from start to finish, and all the badass music and voice acting in the world isn't gonna change that. I was so tired of shootouts and hunting down bandits by the end of this. But in hindsight, I did really enjoy most of everything else. The epilogue probably could have done with some trimming, but the interactions of the cast was still really fun. It was nice seeing so many of the gang members settling down to live peaceful lives, and spending some more time with Uncle Charles and Sadie was great. We also get some insight into how the other members feel about Arthur now that everything is said and done. Even if you do get the good ending, John and Charles still understand that Arthur was a very conflicted man, but they acknowledge that he tried to do good in the end and respect him for that. It's not over-idealized, it feels just right. It gives a nod to what was in Arthur's heart. Either way, Charles went back to the scene of the climax after the dust settles and the law finally catches up to them, and he buries Arthur with a marked grave facing a beautiful mountain range, which is right near where he died if you save John. Depending on the ending you get for Arthur, Charles writes a different inscription on his grave. If you die with low honor, it reads, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." This places emphasis on the others in relation to his death, rather than on the man himself, which makes sense if Arthur himself was less of a good person in that ending. But if you die with high honor, the grave will say, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness," which makes it clear that despite the life he led, Charles understood what was in Arthur's soul. Charles is one of the best characters in the game, and now I feel bad that I didn't talk about him more, but this is already the biggest analysis I've ever made in my life, so leave me alone, okay? Jesus. Anyway, you also, of course, finally get catharsis in the final mission of the epilogue, where at last you get to gun that snake Micah down. I'm not sure if pursuing revenge is the best idea for John, but I do know it feels good. I find it interesting that Dutch actually catches Micah off guard by shooting him, allowing for John to finish him off. It's hard to tell what's going through Dutch's mind at this moment because he effectively just scowls at John and walks away. I'm not complaining, though. I like that even in the end, there's some serious ambiguity to Dutch. He's ultimately a mystery, right up to the end. Fucking Looney Tunes ass death animation. Anyway, that's it, the full story. At the beginning of this video, you might have noticed that I said this game was already in my top 25. And it is. It's just also in my top 10 now. Honestly, it might be top 5. This story genuinely blew my mind. The artistry, detail, and world design is all incredibly impressive. The presentation, music, acting, graphics are all beyond impressive, but it's the story that makes this game transcend anything the studio has made before, and nestles it snugly into the deepest chambers of my heart. Red Dead Redemption 2 is one of those rare AAA games that fully demonstrates what the medium is really capable of. It also makes me even more frustrated with Rockstar, because if this is what they're really capable of, what the hell have they been doing all this time? But either way, this game has left an undeniable mark on my soul. The word mature is often thrown around in critique and marketing as a way to describe anything that's dark, sexual, or violent. And while this game has all three of those elements in spades, the maturity comes from the perspective and emotional honesty on display. Its story takes a very mature, grounded view of something that's often been romanticized and glorified. We are firmly past the days of Wild West tales being taken at face value. Like any people of a powerful nation, Americans have always had a hard time fully coming to grips with the past that made this country what it is. And it would have been easy for Rockstar to go the usual route of making everything as cartoonishly satirical as possible. But they took a different approach here. They created a character that embodies all of the fantasies of the old school Western, and made him strikingly, painfully human. There's no aspect of Arthur's life that isn't treated with brutal honesty. He's ignorant about some things, wise about others. He can be admirable and despicable throughout the course of a single day. But that's what makes him work as a character and as a message. He's the mythology of American heroes made real, and because of him, I can honestly say that Red Dead Redemption 2 is one of the smartest commentaries on American culture I've ever seen. He embodies the best and the worst of us, and I wouldn't have him any other way. I think that the core lesson of this game is a lot like Arthur himself. Simple, but strong. A person can lie, cheat, steal, kill, betray, and break hearts as well as minds. They can be the scum of the earth. They can leave the world a demonstratively colder place for them being in it. But even that kind of person, the kind of person we hesitate to even call human out of some primal shame that we're even the same kind of thing as they are, even that person is human. They love, they lose, they bend and break. They leave a hole when they're gone. And even if they can never wash all the blood from their hands, they can always take a step toward redemption. One of the cruelest things about life is that you're never too far gone until you give up, lay down, and let the good in you die. I've seen a lot of people do just that. There was a time I wanted to do that myself, but while there are mistakes and decisions that can't be undone, there's no such thing as too far gone so that giving up is the only option. You might not be able to earn forgiveness, you might not even ever forgive yourself, but as long as you're breathing, you can do good. You can always do good. That was a really fucking long video. Thank you guys so much for all the patience these last few months. I'm kind of taking a gamble with this format because it's very time-consuming to make, but long videos seem to do well on YouTube, and I've always wanted an excuse to get even more thorough in my game reviews, so here we are. I hope you enjoy the ride, because even though it was a lot of work, I'm genuinely really happy with what I managed to put together, and very grateful for the patrons and audience who made it all possible. Any and all feedback on this video and this format is super appreciated. It's my first time making something quite this massive, so I was a little worried about the pacing or repeating myself too much. But hopefully, it wasn't too bad. If you like this stuff, help. Please help. Like my patrons. The show is frankly not doing so hot. So if you want to support on Patreon or do a one-off donation, that is incredibly helpful. YouTube's algorithm is really killing small creators, and your boy is definitely not an exception to that. If you're new to my little shit show, consider checking out my previous stuff. I've been analyzing, reviewing, and making games for basically my whole life. You can also check out An Outcry, which is the last game project I worked on, which got nominated for an award at IGF, so you must have done something, right? Social media exists, you know all this crap. Join the Discord, though. That's my recommendation. That's where all the cool kids are. Thanks for watching. Wish me luck on my next big project, because there's a lot more on the horizon. And as always, stay safe out there, nerds.